you can make a lot of money and care plenty, because money is a byproduct of value. When we create more value, more money comes. And the thing that we're missing more than anything is vision. The vision for most people is stuck in scarcity, it's in survival. It's about fear, doubt, and worry rather than faith, hope, and love. What I've learned from Jesus and really living a life based upon his teachings and principles at the fullest, and my life has gotten exponentially better through that. The answer is always lead with love, choose love, and find a way to be loving, and it's going to help overcome all this fear, all this frustration, all this anger, what the news is propagating, what social media is trying to decimate people's minds with. Money's not the root of all evil. Money's a man-made tool of efficiency. It's something that allows us to store value. It's a representation of value, but it's not why we're valuable. And if we can start to see people as the value, mm-hmm. and money as the byproduct, it starts to transform things. And if we also start to look at stewardship, which is kind of the main principle, the more impact I make, the more wealth I have. The more wealth I have, I got to continue to be a steward of that, not only with the money principles, but with how I serve humanity, if I want to continue to grow that in a way that is meaningful. To me, comedy felt like love. Like when we laugh, it's because we've struck something in someone that they're no longer worried about the past, or they're not running towards an unknown future or afraid of it. They're just connected in that moment. Yeah. And we have something, and I feel like comedy is the key when no other will do.
Never short stopping, now I'm winning like I'm Jada. Steady through the rigor, yeah, I'm getting bigger.
So my guest today is the author of Killing the Sacred Cow, What Would the Rockefellers Do? And just recently sold his business, The Wealth Factory, and now dedicating his life teaching financial principles through comedy. Yes, it is Garrett Gunderson. Garrett,
what's up, man?
Great to be with you here right
so
before
be
your show
you,
begins, man.
Yeah.
Very cool.
Big night tonight. Rookie comedian, Monday night show, you know?
I saw them putting your name up there, and you know, they got the G, the N, the D, it's making it happen.
Yeah.
So before we talk about comedy real quick, I'm just curious about your entrepreneurial story. And you know, obviously you got this mystique about you, you know, this whole conversation about building a bank through finance, through now comedy. If I was hanging with you in high school, who's this guy, Gary Gunderson? I'm just curious.
Well, I started my first business at 15. I just washed cars, just detailed cars, because my dad was a coal miner.
Got it.
He'd bring home these like surface vehicles when the bosses would come into town. I'd help him wash the cars. My mom worked at a credit union. They'd repossess the vehicles. I'd wash them so they could sell them for more.
Wow.
And then I won the Young Entrepreneur of the Year for the state of Utah when I was a teenager. And
crazy.
I won $5,000. Thought that was a ton of money.
Yeah.
And wanted to invest it, but my family wouldn't sign off as a custodian because they just put cash in a coffee can.
Yeah.
And they put it in the cellar. So they were like scared of everything. And in the path of just trying to figure out what to do when I was 18, I got offered an internship, which sounded cool, but it was more like, hey, bring your friends and family and we'll peddle them some mutual funds and life insurance. That's basically what that internship was. But it's still, I learned some sales, and I also learned when the market went down in 2000, I really got my education because my family had cashed in double E bonds and CDs, and they're putting money in stocks. And in 99, who wasn't? Genius.
Right.
But then in 2000, it's like, hey, what's going on?
Right.
So for the next 26 months, I flew somewhere once a month and used my young age as kind of like leverage to meet with really brilliant minds. Because people like to pay it forward. People like young, inquisitive kids. I had a little red memo pad. I'd go ask questions, fly to New York or wherever, and just start interviewing people.
Wow.
Sat and shadowed some really well-known financial people, watched them give advice, watched them do major transactions, and started to figure out, wait, maybe I could just help people save tax, save interest, save non-performing fees, help them restructure insurances so that they have more money in their pocket, less to the insurance company, and kind of became an efficiency guy.
Yeah.
And then realized no matter what I did there, if I didn't help people with their mindset, it didn't really matter. So we actually launched this entire movement called the Producer Revolution, where we started to do these monthly forums, and we started having pop up all over the place, started a radio show. But yeah, as a kid, I mean, I played sports a little bit in a small town. Everybody got to play sports.
You're a big guy. You're a tall guy. You're a good looking guy. You're like a quarterback.
You'd think I was. I wanted to be a quarterback, but I guess I never was good enough.
You look like Sunshine from what was that movie with Denzel Washington? Was that the greatest? I forgot what movie we're talking about. The Titans. Remembering the Titans. That's correct. Sunshine right here.
So just started in business and then got into finance June of 98 when I was 19 years old. So I've been doing it for 21 years now, but.
I mean, of all businesses you could got involved in, why finance? Why not tech? Why not real estate?
I could hear about stuff in tech. I could never really understand it at the same level. But I could hear something in finance. I could remember it almost like photographically, and I could question and start to analyze, and I had a fascination for it because my family always struggled with money. Fourth generation coal mining family, you know, very up and down, trading time for money. And I knew there was probably a better way to do it. So it fascinated me, and I had a good understanding and comprehension of it. So
your great-grandfather was the Italian immigrant. They couldn't remember his last name because they couldn't understand his gibberish.
I mean, he was cross-eyed, and he couldn't speak English, and he gets on a boat, comes over. His wife is pregnant. He wasn't putting food on the table. So he gets to America to be a coal miner because there were some Greeks and Italians doing that in a small Utah town. Yeah. Big mine explosion happens, so he ends up being a sheep herder for a while.
Wow.
Lived in a tent, eventually became a coal miner. It took him 7 years before he got his family to come over, and he met his daughter when she was about 7 years old for the first time.
Unbelievable. Yeah. How did you know the story of your grandfather? Was it just handed down stories?
Well, like, that was my great-grandfather, but my grandfather was really my hero and the person I spent the most time with.
Yeah.
And he was somewhat entrepreneurial because he worked in the coal mines, but then he had a side business where he was a TV repairman, and he sold Zenith TVs. They were like a big piece of furniture, right?
With three channels.
Yeah, just click right through those things, like little clicker that actually made noise. You can shake your keys and change the channel. So he would just talk about Italy, talk about family, and so I really learned about it from him. And when I was given the opportunity to, you know, graduate college and go work for a bunch of firms, I had some, like at that time, Strong Investments was the number two fund family in the world as far as performance. And I got offered to go work for them in the institutional division because one of my professors used to manage $5 billion for them.
Wow.
And it was an appealing job until I flew to Milwaukee and there was a blizzard. I couldn't see anything when I went until I got into the building.
Welcome to the Midwest.
I don't know if this is really for me. And my wife, we were dating, she's like, maybe I'll follow you to Milwaukee. So it was like, I don't know. But I was already doing okay in finance. And I had a dean that pulled me aside. He goes, hey, stop listening to the professors. They're telling you to go get these jobs because Anderson offered me a good job. You know, they're not even around anymore, right?
Yeah.
Strong's not around anymore.
Yeah.
Merrill Lynch offered me. There's all these job offers.
Merrill's part of Bank of America.
Right. Yeah. So it's like, they seem like the secure path, but my dean's like, you're making more than any of your professors are making it right now. Why listen to them? Just, I was, at the time, basically selling life insurance.
Wow.
That was my main focus by that time.
I didn't realize you're an insurance guy. I'm an insurance guy.
I was an insurance guy. I sold insurance till 2005, one-on-one, and then at that point, to speak at an event, they wanted all these things, and so I decided to become more of an author, use the author exemption. I kind of just became a person that licensed and had referred business out from there.
Smart.
But yeah.
Gotcha.
So that insurance was kind of how I cut my teeth and how I got my start.
It's interesting. You know, we're here in Dallas now, and I didn't realize that Jerry Jones, you know, and all his entrepreneurial moves, one of his first careers and first businesses was selling life insurance. I never knew that. But I want to go back to high school because, you know, you talk about the pain that you had, because I think a lot of people start a career or business because of the pain that they experience as a family member. And so was there like a specific pain, or is this the overall experience of growing up and having the lack of finances? Was there like a pain or a wound that you wanted to make sure that you healed?
Well, my dad went to college, and then his family wasn't doing well enough, so he left college to go to the coal mines to help support his family.
Got it, okay.
And then my parents wouldn't even let me step foot in a coal mine, because when you're a coal miner's son, and it's summertime, they're like, oh, we've got these great jobs for the summer, and they offer, you know, back then it was like $25 an hour, which seemed like a ton of money.
Oh, wow.
And they're like, it's just a trap. They're like, you're doing something else, you're gonna use your mind. And so my parents really invested in that, and I saw the life of all my uncles that are miners, now Trona miners. I saw the life of, you know, my dad, like, pulling out dead bodies during mine rescue. Yeah. I mean, there was just, it wasn't really a great life, and fortunately, I even had, like, teachers that helped me with this rural young entrepreneur competition, and like people that worked with my mom that knew accounting, showed me how to create balance sheets and income statements for my business when I was a teenager. So, and my family was super supportive. My grandfather and grandmother were my first clients. And look, we raised their net worth, this doesn't seem like a lot, but $270,000 over a 9-year period of time when the market took a dive.
Yeah.
And their house was worth $39,000 when they died. So to give perspective of that, and that was like 50,000 tax-free to each one of their kids, and two of their kids within a couple of years had kidney transplants that covered all their co-pays and all that. It was a, I got to see that impact, and they believed in me early on, and that was the helpful thing.
So when you're getting involved in finance, now one of the areas of work that you've done, I think you've studied a lot of, you wrote the book, you know, What Would the Rockefellers Do? What was the most interesting thing as you're doing your research, you're doing a deep dive, obviously, in both the Rockefellers and the Vanderbilts, what was the most impressionable thing that you saw? Because they were both men that built America.
David Rockefeller didn't really know his family was wealthy other than the way that the kids at school would talk about it. But what they would do is they would do these semi-annual retreats where all the Rockefellers would get together and they would like do these, you know, like investing in their education and how to manage money. And they weren't just handing it off to the person and saying, here you go, or the Vanderbilts. I mean, Cornelius had more money than the US Treasury at one point. He passed it on to his eldest son, who doubled that over 9 years and then died. And then the next 54 years was a trail that led to the first Vanderbilt dying broke. And they owned 10 properties in Manhattan that they don't own anymore. They own the Biltmore Estate, they don't own that. They own the Breakers in Rhode Island. They became wealthy socialites because they never really talked about like how to develop as a person. They didn't really have these principles. They didn't really have these conversations that the Rockefellers did. And now the Rockefellers have over 200 people benefiting from the trust, but you don't really see the trustafarian, you know, trust fund babies that aren't doing anything. Where the Vanderbilts, I mean, yeah, there's Vanderbilt University. They gave them $1 million, but compared to what they had.
Yeah. Did they change the name from what, Central University to Vanderbilt University? Was it?
Yeah, so it's like they, you know, so they donate some money. So I just saw that they had completely different methodologies of how they handled things in their family, even though it was an extraordinary amount of wealth. And, you know, there's things that you could find fault in along the way, but there were so many good things. And I think the Rockefellers pretty much coined the term family office, where they had these financial people that worked just for their family, right? So now they had continuity when a Rockefeller would die. It was comprehensive, it was coordinated, they all communicated with each other. The Rockefellers knew it existed. They had this family bank that they could utilize the funds and not have to rely on everything else. And they had rituals, traditions, and symbols within the family that kind of held it together. It's like they ran their family like a business.
And
businesses have meetings, and they have mission statements.
And accountability,
they have,
responsibility.
Right, and they have logos, and they have, and that's basically what the Rockefellers did. And you saw that, you know, pass on a lot of wealth over these generations.
You know, a lot of people didn't realize that Anderson Cooper was actually a Vanderbilt.
Mm-hmm.
He was the son of
Gloria
Vanderbilt,
right.
socialite, the fashionista, all that stuff.
Right.
He has an article out there that he doesn't believe in
inheritance.
He doesn't believe it. So your comments on that.
Right, he had to fight for his credentials, and he didn't have money handed down to him. I get that there's a lot of people, if they're not intentional, I find that two things happen. Either one, they go, I'm going to give everything to charity because I'm worried about ruining my kids, or I'm just going to give the money to my kids, and a lot of times that does create a problem. Yeah. Instead of being intentional, I believe in like having a family constitution, which captures your core principles, philosophies, and it's the preamble to your trust.
Yeah.
So now you have like your most important lessons that are left behind as signposts that can be a dynamic way for people to start interpret what has happened, why the family earned the money, and start to pass on these values that start to live in future generations instead of just handing down money. I think passing money on to the next generation tax-free is the easy part. I think having the person not feel entitled, not become spoiled, requires a lot of attention and intention along the way. So these family retreats that are happening all the time, a family office is part of that component, that family constitution that says, here's what we stand for, here's who we are, here's our mission statements, here's our guidance, here's our principles, and this is what we live by, and you start to instill that at a young age.
Yeah.
So it becomes part of how that family operates versus ignoring it, and then all of a sudden a bunch of money comes in and they're like, cool, let's go spend.
Right. For example, a lot of people today, sadly, because of certain policies over the years, they've been married and divorced. And there's a lot of blended families that happen. I'm a blended family between my wife and I. So how do you install that with older kids that, sadly, go back to the parents that's not part of this family conversation? They go back to, let's say, for example, we're capitalistic parents, but the exes are more socialistic.
Right. We saw a family come in their late 60s and work with Wealth Factory. And we were doing these legacy events. And the thing is, they're bringing in kids and even grandkids that they didn't have this along the way. But what happened is it transformed their family, even though they started late, because they really got intentional about it, which the crazy thing is, They were only doing like $1 million of revenue when they came in. And even doing the family work led to over $10 million of revenue within 3 years.
Wow.
Because you had the mom who's in her late 60s wanting to be a grandma, but she's trying to help her husband in business. He's constantly so busy and overwhelmed. Yeah. And then it turns out his son and daughter-in-law both had skill sets and connections that they brought into the business that started to grow that business. Now he's working 25 hours a week, retires his wife from having to work in the business. She gets to be a grandma. Mm. And all of a sudden there's room for creativity. Yeah. There's new conversations happening within the family. So that's someone who started late. That's someone who their kids were already in their late 30s and they had the grandkids. But it just takes like starting with, how do you have the first family retreat? I always recommend finding something that would be fun for the family to get them together and just have an hour where you just dedicate a conversation. So rather than trying to do it perfect all at once, because there might be people that are, you know, harder to you know, have conversations
with,
you know, they're on a second marriage, or there's, you know, or there's someone that doesn't, you know,
buy into
come
it
to
way.
Stuff or everything. Yeah. And it leads by example, but allowing people to start, have a voice, because people support that which they help to build.
Yeah.
And when they can actually start to build it, like when we built our family mission statement, we actually have a big, you know, metal, looks like a medieval shield that's above our, and our kids got to talk about, what are the symbols that are gonna be on that? What do we stand for? Yeah. Who are we? And then we unveil it to the whole family.
Yeah.
And then we have these weekly meetings where we're talking about, and weekly, that's maybe a stretch. Most of the time, we have these meetings and we're just like, hey, how are we doing on a scale of 1 to 10 as parents? What skill are you working on this week? Let's read through the family values this week. Next week, maybe we read through the family mission statement. So we have the very things that any business would have, but start integrating in the family so it starts to become part of our lives. And I get it could be complex over time. There could be divorces. There could be, you know, turmoil within the family. But I think you start to diminish some of that by having this happen. And then maybe that first time you get together, there's an hour spent on it. And then you're like, hey, we'd like to do another one where we maybe spend a little bit more time. We'd like to hear what your thoughts are on it. Maybe even bring someone in to facilitate so that it's not the pressure just on one person who.
Smart.
Yeah.
Yeah. By the way, that means sit down, have a conversation, put the phones away, right? And have actually conversation and dialogue.
Yeah, it changed our family's life when we went to Italy for a summer where we weren't on the phones all the time. You'd go into the town square, this little town called Capalbio. There'd be like 100 people in this little town square getting gelato. They're playing cards. There's no phones. And I think it really got me connected to my kids at a different level.
Hmm.
And it got us to like start talking about things we wouldn't talk about because we're in the pool every day.
Yeah.
We're playing cards every day.
Yeah.
It just kind of broke the patterns of business that we have in our lives.
How old are your kids now?
They're 13 and 16. And my youngest, actually, when we filmed my special, opened for me and did comedy.
Yeah, very
so
cool.
So 13 years old, crushed it, took the energy of the crowd up. It was really cool.
Are they boys, girls? Was
two boys.
Two older boys. You got a king's family, man.
Yeah, the 16-year-old, you know, he's a little harder to get engaged sometimes. You know, we have a cabin that we go to. And then we have these traditions that we do, like that the kids will drop about anything for. We have this thing called the Christmas roast.
Okay.
Where you draw names. And so you kind of draw names, but you kind of sometimes cheat and ask for a name. And it's like permission to roast someone else in the family and just relentlessly tease them. And the kids are now involved in it. They film videos, they put on skits. So it's something you're like, ooh, this is what I'm trying to do is stack the favor that they want to keep coming back during these times. I want to create odds that they're like, that's something I don't want to miss, right? That's the traditions.
I love it. That's awesome. Now, I know you were born and raised in Utah.
Mm-hmm.
And I know for a lot of people, the religion in Utah is predominantly Mormon.
Right.
But you're Christian.
I'm not Mormon. My dad's side of the family, his dad was definitely Mormon.
Okay.
A bishop. And his great-great-grandfather was Mormon royalty, a president of the Mormon church.
Wow.
But my mom, being Catholic, or being Italian, was Catholic.
Sure.
And so I kind of grew up Catholic. I retired from the Catholic church. There was a little bit too much guilt and shame for me involved in that personally, you know? We had a good structure, and it's interesting to have a Mormon and a Catholic married to each other. Most people just figure I'm from Utah, I must be Mormon.
You know, I've learned a lot about money and business, oddly enough, from both Jewish and Mormons. You know, it's just
both known to be very good with business.
Very strong in that regard.
My entire comedy team around me is all Jewish, and they're amazing. I'm really glad to have them. You know, one of my business partners at Wealth Factory, same. I mean, just very, very intelligent.
Yeah. So what is it do you see in their families? Because I see a lot. They're big families.
They do put an emphasis on family. But they also have an emphasis on business. Like, I think the number one demographic for orthodontists is Mormons, because it's just known as like, hey, you get to stay at home and be with your family, you can make a good living. Like, there is a lot of intention in that, in being family oriented and being mission oriented. So there's some really great qualities within that.
You know, where you see people today, you know, where so many things are divided. You know, America right now is so separated, whether it be religion, politics, and and so many different biases today. You know, how do you feel, you know, where we are with our country? You know, you got so many social programs going out. Biden wants to give away everything. You know.
Yeah, well, he once said we want to have a bigger, better government, which seemed like an oxymoron.
Exactly.
Like, so, because here's what we're missing is responsibility.
That's it.
That's the key. And and we're also missing just sitting down and talking. Like, I feel like the news does a great job at fanning the flame inside of the brain that says, hey, this is negative, and we want you to get addicted to negativity, and then we want to be divisive, this camp versus that camp. Like, to me, my politics are how I spend my money every day, how I treat people every day. Because one thing I know is, regardless of what politician's in, they don't have the power for each individual to find their own way to be responsible, add value, have a vision, and create a life that they love. When they say, you know, like communists would say, oh, well, we're going to provide for you. How are you going to do that? Only by force, and probably extraordinarily poorly, if at all. It's a false, hollowed promise that usually puts all the power in the government's hands and leaves the people in shambles. And logically, people are going, yeah, but this is the one that says we care about each other. Well, guess what? You can make a lot of money and care plenty, because money is a byproduct of value. When we create more value, more money comes. And money is just a form that says, I'm going to store this energy of what I've created from value in the past and the value I have today, but it doesn't dictate what I do in the future. It's just a resource. And when we're intelligent about that resource, profit is actually evidence of value creation. But unfortunately, people in communism or socialism think it's evidence of deception or coercion, which is only the exception to the case, not the majority of the time. And so this false narrative that, hey, we've got to just be taken care of by a government. How is the government ever going to be capable of taking care of people at that level? They're not. We all have to wake up and say, what can I do today to serve people, to solve problems, to add value? And the thing that we're missing more than anything is vision. The vision for most people is stuck in scarcity. It's in survival. It's about fear, doubt, and worry rather than faith, hope, and love. It's about what can I get and what can I take rather than what can I create. And when we can really rise up and embrace who we are in a profound way and step outside of that fear and start to embrace abundance and start to really choose love with other people and say, how can I really be of service? The world transforms and changes. In this crazy kind of like mental civil war that we're seeing politically in this divide, unfortunately, what it's doing is it's getting people stuck in things that don't matter as much as just like helping, just doing something. It's getting people in these different camps. And what I am proud of right now in America that not enough people are talking about is that people are saying, you know, I'm going to stand up, and I don't care whether you're going to give me a check for free, I'm going to work. And we're starting to see that. Hey, if you tell me I have to do this to get a job, I'll go ahead and quit and find a way to be more free and do what's best for my family, even if it means it's temporarily uncomfortable. Because I think the biggest problem we've had economically as a nation, as a world, is that people continue to do things that aren't of the highest use and good because they're saying they want to put food on the table. So they'll work for a company that doesn't have good intentions, that are doing destructive things to the world, and they're good people because they just go, well, I just got to keep providing. And now people are starting to wake up to that and say, there's got to be a better way. I'm not just going to have you force my hand. And, you know, I'm proud that some people are standing up. Now, it's not everybody. But it just takes a few people to start doing it and show that there's a path. And then we can support each other, and nobody has to force us to support each other. That we could just do it out of humanity. And I think that we're in for some interesting times, but I also think it's kind of some karma in the world that people are going to start to see, hey, I've got to be responsible for my own prosperity.
Yeah, you mentioned there's a bit you're stepping to do your comedy routine. You step and say, "Hey, listen, it's okay. You know, I'm not Jesus, right?" So you, you kind of got that look, right? So how has faith how has your faith both impacted you, both from the Mormon influence, the Catholic faith-based influence? How has that affected your value principles creation in your family, the way you handle money and business? How has that affected you?
Well, so for me, I grew up and had this priest, Father Mike, who was amazing, because he had one message: know you're loved. And in college, this is really good to hear. And like, he just would always make sure that you knew that at every turn. And I even wrote him a letter. I'm surprised he's still alive. He's got to be 90. I couldn't read his handwriting.
Yeah.
But like, that message permanently impacted me. But I was also the inquisitive kid saying, why did this have to happen? You know, and why are we doing this? And what's going on here?
Yep.
And I got kind of labeled as a fanatic. And it wasn't really until January of 2020 that I really came back into embracing like who I am and what I've learned from Jesus and really living a life based upon his teachings and principles at the fullest. And my life has gotten exponentially better through that.
Mm-hmm.
It's not something I necessarily talk about all the time, but I put a tattoo on my shoulder for the first time just this year to remind me that if we just like, because my question that could never be answered in Catholic school is like, why did Jesus die on the cross? They'd say, oh, it's part of the mission. It's just part of the plan. It was part of this. And now I'm like, oh, he showed us that if you approach anything with love and compassion, that you could face any pain. And on the other side of that is consciousness and connection. And if he would have hidden or if he would have cowered, it would have demolished his message of love. And he faced that and he sacrificed so the rest of us don't. And so I'm out here in a message of we don't have to sacrifice who we are just for a paycheck. We don't have to sacrifice who we are or our principles just to appease someone else.
Yeah.
Because I may not have all the answers, but one thing I saw with him is the answer is always lead with love, choose love, and find a way to be loving. And it's going to help overcome all this fear, all this frustration, all this anger, what the news is propagating, what social media is trying to decimate people's minds with, and just, you know, hug someone. Just talk to someone.
What's some of the faith-based Bible myths that you, in your journey of teaching financial principles, that people have as a mystique or a myth they've held on to because religion told me that you find through your comedy now that you're starting to break loose and people say, oh, I get it now.
Money is the root of all evil is a big one, right? I mean, like, I really like the parable of the talents talking about.
Come on, man, it's my favorite.
Right, like, oh, you know, we're going to bury that versus right. like the person Invest, who goes out there and multiplies it. That's the whole message that we've been saying here today. And so money's not the root of all evil. Money's a man-made tool of efficiency. It's something that allows us to store value. It's a representation of value, but it's not why we're valuable. And if we can start to see people as the value and money as the byproduct, it starts to transform things. And if we also start to look at stewardship, which is kind of the main principle, is like, we've got to meet God halfway, right? Like, like you can have all the talent in the world, but if you don't develop that or utilize that to bless someone else's life, it diminishes. It's not very useful. Yeah. And so money is a byproduct of how many people we impact or how deeply we impact those that we're actually serving. And it allows a very efficient exchange. And so to me, that could be a very spiritual concept of the more impact I make, the more wealth I have. The more wealth I have, I got to continue to be a steward of that, not only with the money principles, but with how I serve humanity if I want to continue to grow that in a way that is meaningful. Because if people get in a place where they're just scrimping and saving and budgeting and scraping by and they're trying to reduce expenses and cut back, they start to lose sight of the person on the other side.
Got it.
Right?
Yeah. And you call yourself, in one of your talks, you said, I'm a recovering
miser. Yeah.
Right? We've been married for 17 years. 15 of those years are great.
Yeah.
So talk to us.
Because my first year of marriage, I was such a miser that my wife was like, I think she was going, why did I marry this guy? Like my father-in-law, her dad goes, hey, if you want to live in the basement, it'll be rent-free. And she turned to me and she says, sex-free too, if that's where you decide we're going to live. So I got to give it to her. She stood strong on that. And our quality of life has immensely improved because, you know, she's been a fight for like, hey, what do you want in this world? Like, what does family mean to you? What do you want? Like, when I said, hey, I want to sell my business and I want to do comedy, we're economically independent. So she's like, great. As much as that might seem scary to a lot of you know, spouses that might be looking for stability, she just...
Because how long did you have your business?
I mean, I started my business in 2000.
So 20 years.
Yeah. And so, and it was November. I just had this moment where I was like, yeah, this is what's supposed to happen. I had a dream and it was like very spiritual. And I was like...
20 years now. You sold that. You're moving on to the next phase of your life.
Because I feel like... My mission is to plant a seed of hope, connection, and expression in the hearts of a billion people to help restore love to humanity. And entertainment is the gateway to that. Entertainment is the language of the masses. So many people are intimidated by money. They're confused about how all this works. And if I can get them to laugh, they learn three times more. And we can address a topic that the masses might not take into consideration. Look, I get it. Like, I worked with plenty of people that were wealthy, not the wealthiest, but I worked with plenty of wealthy people. What about everybody else? And I was like, this is my chance to make a bigger impact and have a lot of fun doing it.
That's huge. I mean, who are your comedic inspirations growing up? Because for me, obviously, it's got to be Eddie Murphy at the top for me, man.
You know? Oh, I mean, that was insane that he was like 20-some years old walking out doing Delirious and Raw. Delirious, the ice cream bit. I mean, that's, you know.
Hey, Norton Bam.
So, you know, as a kid, I love it. Like, I don't know if this is the most popular, but I remember in the 1980s listening to Bill Cosby himself.
Yeah. Sure.
And that was hilarious, and I thought that was great. Yeah. And then what I really thought was awesome was my families would get together, and it didn't matter whether it was the Mormon side or the Catholic side. You could get away with anything if it was a joke. You could say something that was a little dirty and you're too young to say it. You could swear, but I'd learn the dirty jokes from my uncles. I would learn them, you know, and I would repeat them. And my grandma just turned 90, and the thing she wanted her birthday, everybody's at the park, she's like, when are you gonna tell your jokes? Now, these are jokes that would get me canceled if I told them publicly. They're jokes that I learned and regurgitated and evolved, but she just loves it. I'm like, Grandma, how can you be a 90-year-old Mormon and laugh at a joke that ends with the punchline, twat? It doesn't seem right, you know? But that's what she loves. So to me, comedy felt like love. Like when we laugh, it's because we've struck something in someone that they're no longer worried about the past, or they're not running towards an unknown future or afraid of it. They're just connected in that moment. And we have something. And I feel like comedy is the key when no other will do, right? Love might be the answer, but can't always break through. That's like something that I wrote one day, and I was like, that's the key. It's like, I want to bring something up. And then I'm like, satire is pointing out something that everybody already knew, but no one would mention, right? So it's like, so I just started to see like, hey, look what this did for my family when I was a kid. It lights me up, it challenges me. Yeah. I mean, it's crazy. I'll just be on this stage tonight with a mic and my thoughts, right? And what I know is I'm funniest when the only thought I have is the thought I'm sharing with the crowd. If I have any thought in my head that I'm not sharing with them, it's not as funny. So Thursday night,
I'm
just connected. So like when I film my special, I only said two words in my head that I didn't speak out loud. And it was in the second show. It was 10:30 p.m. I'd been on stage for 3.5 hours. And I said, I'm tired in my head. And I go, oh, I just stopped the joke. I went and sat in the chair, took a drink of water. I go, hey, I just want to let you know, there was only one currency that mattered tonight, and it's love. You were here tonight because I love you, and I invited you to be here. And this is why I'm doing comedy. And all of a sudden, it re-energized us all. And then I went back into the jokes and finished strong. And so comedy is teaching me how to be present with people. It's teaching me how to connect with people in a very quick way. Yeah. And I actually, like, I don't sell anything at the end of the show, but I give away my books. So I just sign books. I'm like, hey, hopefully you laugh, but hopefully you learn too. Oh. And so I think it's a new modality because I'm the court jester of finance. I'm just going to say the things that nobody else can say because they're going to be attacked or, you know, people are frustrated about. So I'm like, why don't I just say it in comedy? Yeah. And then maybe they'll go, huh, that was kind of a good point. Yeah. You know, I have a line where I'm like, hey, money, make me happy. And then I'm talking about we put false expectations on money. And, you know, so it's just.
Can't wait to hear your bit, man.
Yeah, man. Thanks.
I'm looking forward to it. I always considered comedy is the highest form of public speaking because it's the toughest thing to do. In my opinion, it's one of the toughest things because not only do you have to get over being nervous, but this is the number one fear for a lot of people is to get in front of people in public speaking. But then you gotta keep their attention, create a reaction.
I thought the same thing until I tried one other thing out. So another night I have this dream and I'm in Broadway and I'm directing a Broadway show, but up on the Broadway stage, it's a one man show and I think that might be me. So I wake up in the morning, I turn to my wife, I'm like, I'm gonna write a one man show. She's like, what's that? I'm like, well, it's a performance to help people. I'll use acting and music and spoken word and play four characters in this acting. Wow. And the first time I tried to act these four characters in front of my director, it was hard. And like every word matters so much in the play because I'm playing guitar and I'm taking people through an exercise so they could feel abundant, not just hear what abundance is. Yeah. And I'm using spoken word as a white boy. Like I'm doing all this kind of stuff. And that has actually been harder than comedy. I probably spent three more times working on it, but I've only done it publicly once because of COVID, and it was just a trial, and it was the day after I filmed my comedy special, and 80% of the room was crying, and it's the longest standing ovation I've ever got, not just because of what I did, but how people felt about themselves. I felt like at the end of that, they had a mirror up to themselves, in a way that was stickier in their mind. They could be like, oh, that's a good point, that's a good line. And like, so that's actually been harder for me than comedy.
Wow, okay.
Maybe because I was telling jokes from the time I was a kid and I hadn't really acted before, you know? And so I'm still working through it, I mean, just on a regular basis, and I'm gonna be doing that one as well.
Hey, because most guys are usually, financial guys are usually stiff. You know, you gotta be perfect, you know, mahogany desk. So when you're looking at your creativity, your books, it seems that you know how to get things out of your head and onto paper. So do you have a process? Do you have like a formula? Do you have a code? If somebody's watching this right now, I want to get this out of my head onto paper, how to write a book, how to write a one-man show. How would you help them get that process?
I think everybody kind of has their own process, but what worked for me was, one, I like to text myself when I have an idea. I like to do audio recordings if I'm talking to someone and something's coming out, okay, and then transcribe those or use it, something automatically transcribes it. And then I like to go up to my cabin where I have a little bit of peace, and I can just go up and write a little bit every day, and go shoot my bow for a minute or walk the river, and then come back to writing. And I really like to do really sloppy writing where I'll just like write an outline and then I'll just start filling it in and write a little bit further outline and start to fill it in. And then the key for me is co-creation. So once I get it just a little bit of an idea, who's someone that I can talk to or write with or edit with that pulls the best out in me? They ask me the right questions and I go, oh, I didn't think of that. Or I explain it to them and then we get in that kind of back and forth. And I think too much of the world is stuck in isolation, thinking they have to do it themselves. But I feel like co-creation, whether it's my comedy, whether it's my one-man show, one of the first things I do is go, okay, it's a one-man show, who's my director gonna be? Who's the screenwriter gonna be that I'm gonna work with on this? And then really taking time for self-care and a hobby. I think one of the most underestimated things for anyone that wants to be creative is taking time for themselves that has nothing to do with business, because it creates that void where there's a blank slate for creation. Gotcha. So for some that might be fly fishing, some it might be painting, some that might be playing the guitar or some other instrument or golf, but it's time where you're not listening to something but yourself. And when you can get to that place where you can listen to the light nudge or that light feather to the face or that gut feeling, like I'll have moments where I'm like, I don't even know where this came from that I wrote, because I feel like it's a gift for me that I didn't ever say. Yeah. Like there's sometimes I've written poems, like I'll end my comedy thing with this poem that just absolutely like connects me to everybody. Like when it came through, it was like, how did this come through? But it, you know, so it's like, you gotta create that space. And then you just gotta find your co-creator that brings the best out in you, so that you don't get stuck just doing everything on your own.
Be like a ghostwriter or something like that.
Ghostwriter could help too. Yeah, a lot of people, I'm now in the, my first one was a ghostwriter when I wrote Killing Sacred Cows, but now I like to have like an editor. So I'm still writing and then they kind of like go, hey, this is, okay, you're going a little too deep here. Let's talk about what did you mean here and how did this work? And then we'll do phone calls back and forth. Like I'm talking next Monday to a children's author that sold 3 million books. She's just gonna interview me the whole time, and then she wants to put it in a children's format. So that's like that co-creation can really unlock things.
Gotcha. As I wrap this up, I can talk to you, you know, for hours and hours, man. But with your career now and the things you're about to come out with and say, with you know the whole David Chappelle special and the whole Netflix rising up, you know, and the irony between Netflix employees allowing things like Cuties to go out, which is basically child soft porn, versus you know, David Chappelle, who's, hey, you know, he said a couple things about trans, nothing really demeaning, but he says something about trans, and everybody wants to walk out of Netflix now. So how do you feel about your career right now? Are there things that you're guarded about that you think you can't really freely express and say because you feel like we're getting canceled, or are you just going through
it? I feel like censorship is creating so much inner turmoil. When people tell you what you can and can't say, like, here's part of the problem. I did this one-man show practice, and someone says, well, who cares what some rich white dude has to say? And part of my problem with that is, when we're kids, some people have more horrific childhood than others, but when we're kids, it's hard to tell the difference sometimes. Everything just, when it's tough, it feels tough.
Yeah.
Like, you know, I got hit by a car when I was 3. That shaped a lot of things. I got molested when I was 5. That shaped a lot of things. Like, so, but at the same time, I woke up once and my mom wasn't there when I woke up from a nap and I felt abandoned. Like, it, threshold. And so as soon as we say that because of who you are, because of the amount of money you have, or because your life wasn't as tough as someone else's, you no longer have a valid opinion, that starts to chip away at the spirit and essence of who we are as human beings. It's time for people to find their voice, to speak up. They might say things that you abhor. They might say things that absolutely are the opposite of who you are. But if they hold that in, that emotion is going to come through in a really negative way that has them get disenchanted with humanity. And guess what? Whether you like how the conversation comes up or not, comedians need to get back to that place where they speak their truth. So whether you agree or not, it opens up a conversation. And if you're fired up, then do something about it. But to me, to cancel someone because of something they said has people actually have these feelings that might be homophobic or racist or whatever, you know, anti-Semitic, that they never speak because of the ignorance, because they always hold something in because of something that happened, instead of having a conversation with someone. One of my really good friends, and we had the most uncomfortable conversation because he's black, and I'm trying to understand how racism is, and it was a painful, hard, we're still friends, but I was like, help me. Yes. You know, I'm like, well, what's the problem here? How do we get through it? And he's like, it's your problem, not mine. And it was like, yeah, man, I'm trying to figure it out. Not that he was calling me a racist, but he's saying because I'm white. But most people are afraid to ever have that conversation because they don't want to say the wrong thing. They want to hurt someone's feelings at the expense of their own voice. Mm. And as long as we're letting everyone else say what's politically correct, what's right and wrong, and what you can and can't do, then what we start doing is going to the lowest common denominator where people lose themselves. Yeah. And so what Chappelle did was gutsy. You know, and he even said, hey, I don't have a problem with LGBTQ, I have a problem with white people. That's the thing that I heard. And I was like, okay, well, I understand, because we still haven't addressed what happened with slavery and the way that we live today. We haven't addressed what happened to Native Americans and the way that we live today. Mm-hmm. And it's time to have a real conversation and start doing something about it. And if the comedian's going to lead the way, then the comedian's going to lead the way.
That's it. Bobby Garrett, where can people find more information about you and connect with you?
GarrettGunderson.com.
Simple as that. Folks, if you've been watching this, if you have your thoughts, your comments, your questions, your fear, put it in the comment section below. I'd love to know what you're thinking. And if you haven't done so already, make sure you follow Garrett's material. I just started following him on Instagram too as well. And if you're watching this on Facebook, make sure you haven't done so, make sure you click like and follow our Facebook page, Money Smart Guy. If you're watching this on YouTube, make sure you click subscribe and hit notifications to be alerted the next time we upload our next episode. That being said, on behalf of Garrett Gunderson, cannot wait for his show tonight. Be Money Smart Guy. Until we meet again, continue to live smart, continue to love smart, and be money smart today. Let the last begin. Appreciate you.
Thanks, man.
Awesome.